Hi, everyone. Thank you, and it's an honor for me to be with you today. And thanks, Dr. Richardson, for hosting this event. And I have to mention, like in the beginning, that one of the unique things here at Dana-Farber that the big harmony between the clinical side and the research side, and how we always in our research learn from our mentors like Dr. Richardson and Dr. Gorbian and others, how that we have to be patient-centered in our research and how to direct all the findings that we are getting in the lab to better care for our patients. So today I will talk with you about smoldering multiple myeloma, and I'm going to share some of the slides that we presented at ASH this year, and it got like a very positive feedback because it's considered the first genetic analysis for smoldering myeloma patients in an attempt to understand how the genetic background affects patient and how they can develop multiple myeloma and how it unfolds through time from the asymptomatic disease to the symptomatic one. So this is the work that I did with my mentor, Dr. Irene Gabriel. And as we all know, that multiple myeloma, sure. Yeah, is it better like that? Okay. So as we know, multiple myeloma is considered the second most common adult hematologic malignancy. And as Dr. Anderson mentioned, estimated like 30,000 cases. And we know also that multiple myeloma almost always arises from two precursor conditions. The first one is MGUS that develops after that to smoldering multiple myeloma. And we believe that all patients who present with symptomatic multiple myeloma with the symptoms like anemia, bone lesions, and renal problems, at a certain time in their lifetime, they had a sort of precursor condition, but because it was asymptomatic, so that's why it was not recognized. And according to Dr. Robert Kyle's study that when he, like Dr. Anderson mentioned, we know that the prevalence of MGUS is almost 3% in US population. And the concept of cancer evolution from precursor lesions is very, it's one of the hallmarks of cancer. And we see it in many other cancers. So for example, we know that colon cancers, there is a precursor, which is the polyps or adenoma that can predispose the patient to an overt colon cancer. We know also that breast cancer is preceded by a precancerous lesion that's called ductal carcinoma in situ, where it's precancerous lesion that can progress to symptomatic breast cancer and metastatic lesions. So this is a common concept and phenomena in many cancers. However, in most of these cancers, there is a sort of intervention, like either medically or surgically. However, so far in the smoldering, we didn't, as a standard of care, we do not intervene. This study that was done by Dr. Kyle when he prospectively followed 248 patients with smoldering multiple myeloma for almost 25 years of follow-up. And based on the results of this study, we knew that the annual risk of progression of a smoldering multiple myeloma is almost 10% per year in the first 5 years. And this risk decreases after that. However, if, for example, we know that 50% of the patient can progress within 5 years, and almost in 15 years, we see that 73% of the patients will progress to multiple myeloma. MGUS, as you see here, it's different in its form, so we have it like the annual risk of progression is almost 1% or 1.5%. This is like a diagram of how the precursor condition, either MGUS or smoldering, evolves through time. So we believe that there are some risk factors in the normal cells that can predispose patients to develop MGUS. However, to have MGUS, certain mutation or genetic aberrations has to occur that produce the abnormal protein in the blood, and acquiring new mutations will cause more growth and progression of the disease that then after eventually will be like will present with symptoms that we all know about, and then a very heterogeneous tumor will be like present in our bone, in the bone marrow, that can cause the symptoms that we all know about. One main thing is that it's not only the plasma cells, the abnormal plasma cells and the mutations they acquire is the problem, but it's also like an interaction between the immune microenvironment and the abnormal malignant cells. So we believe that there is a sort of immune inhibition of the immune cells, so they can't recognize the cancer cells, and thus this will provide more growth and evolution of the malignant clones. Not only immune cells contribute to the progression of myeloma, but also the stromal cells, which are the normal cells that are found in the bone marrow that can provide growth factors and signaling pathways that can make myeloma cells grow more and more. So the progression, it's not just acquiring mutations of the plasma cells, but it's an interaction between the malignant cells and the bone marrow microenvironment with immune cells and the stromal cells as well. And we believe that this is what makes some patients, these three factors are what makes some patients progress faster than others, and maybe some of the patients will not progress because they didn't acquire specific mutations, or the bone marrow microenvironment was not permissive for the growth of the myeloma cells, so they didn't develop the symptomatic disease. This is like a figure, and it summarizes the genetic abnormalities in multiple myeloma. And we know that the primary events are mainly translocations, as Dr. Anderson mentioned earlier, like translocation in 414, 1114, and so on, or hyperdiploidy, which is an increase in the odd number chromosomes. And then we believe that with these translocations or primary events, there are other mutations that occur either in the same time of the translocations or at later time points that might give the malignant cells a kind of growth advantage that they can proliferate more and then they can cause the symptoms. However, with fish data that Dr. Anderson also mentioned earlier, we can only detect the translocations. We can't detect these mutations that we heard about earlier in this morning, like NRAS, KRAS, and other mutations. Clinically, there are some prognostic models that came out for smoldering multiple myeloma. One of the main ones is the Mayo Clinic risk model. And basically, it depended on three variables or three biomarkers, which are M protein above 3 g/dL, more than 10% bone marrow cells, and free light chain ratio above 8 or below 0.125. And they give a score for each risk factor. And this is what we always hear about if a patient is low risk or intermediate risk or high risk smoldering. So if a patient has only one risk factor, then they will be low risk smoldering. If they have two risk factors, they will be intermediate risk smoldering. Or if they have the three risk factors, they will be in the high risk category. And as you see here, when they build this model, they build it based on 5 years progression. So for example, patient who has three risk factors are having 76% chance of progression within 5 years. And of course, clinical models were great, but when they tried to validate it on other cohorts, they found it not that reproducible, because variations happens. And for example, patients with light chain smoldering multiple myeloma will never be categorized as high risk smoldering according to this model, because it gives the M protein one of the values. So what we try to do here is that how we can first understand, based on next generation sequencing techniques, how we can understand the progression and how the biology of the disease occurs and how smoldering multiple myeloma progress to overt myeloma and why some patients they will not progress in 5 or 10 years. The other thing that we try to do is that we identify genetic abnormalities that are significantly associated with disease progression. And these genetic abnormalities are not detected by the regular FISH studies, but they are detected by the new technologies like sequencing. And the third and main objective is that how we can integrate this genetic markers with the clinical markers to better stratify patient and to more precisely predict who are the patients who will progress within 2 years instead of just knowing that the risk of progression will be 50% in 5 years or so on. Most of the samples that we worked on were from Dana-Farber, and there was a center that founded here at Dana-Farber by Irene and others. It's called the Center for Progression for Prevention of Disease Progression, and it's mainly a blood and tissue banking for the precursor conditions of all blood cancers. This tissue bank now is the main part that we depended on having the samples that we sequenced. It's now having more than 1,000 samples, either bone marrow or blood samples from precursor conditions of different blood cancers. 848 of them are smoldering and MGUS patients, with also Waldenstrom patients, which is the cousin of multiple myeloma. 165 of them with MDS, which is a precursor for acute myeloid leukemia, and 50 of them with MBL, which is monoclonal B-cell lymphocytosis, which is a precursor for chronic lymphocytic leukemia. Participants in this study are from 47 states. 630 of them are females, as always expected. They were more active in participating. 433 are males. And now it extended even beyond the US, and now we have patients from Europe sending their samples and even up to Australia and Israel. This is whoever wants or interested in knowing more, they can Google it and see how they can participate. Going back to the results of our study, as you see here, we put the patients according to the clinical risk criteria as high risk, intermediate risk, and low risk. And we found that the mutations, the known mutations in multiple myeloma were present in the three risk groups. They were not exclusive just to the high risk or intermediate risk, but we found them also in the low risk groups, with also MYC aberrations and amplifications found in mainly the intermediate risk and high risk group. And this gives us a sense that even those who were categorized as low risk clinically, they had mutations that are known to be recurrently mutated in multiple myeloma. And we tried then to know what's the significance of the presence of these mutations on the risk of progression of those patients. In 64 patients who progressed, that we had a very good follow-up time for them, we saw that patients who progressed are mainly harboring mutations in the MAPK kinase pathway, like KRAS, NRAS, and BRAF mutations, and also in the MYC gene that described before by Dr. Anderson. And we found that most of the patients who progressed were having or harboring these mutations. However, if you see here, patients who didn't progress are either having mutations that were not aggressive enough to cause progression, or even they didn't have these mutations at all. This is a survival curve analysis, and what we saw that patients who are having the MYC, and as we said, as mentioned before in this morning, MYC is a very well-known gene that causes cancer in many types, solid tumors, blood cancers, and a lot of others. So we found that patients who, at time of diagnosis, was smoldering multiple myeloma, who had the MYC aberrations, either translocations or amplifications, we saw that the median time to progression, which is the time from the diagnosis with smoldering multiple myeloma to the time of diagnosis with the overt disease that required therapy, we found that 50% of them were progressed in 1 year. So from the time of diagnosis till the time of progression, 50% of patients who had this aberrations progressed in 1 year, compared to 3.8 years in patients who didn't have this mutation. And after that, we ran another kind of analysis to see if it's an independent risk factor, and we found indeed that MYC was an independent risk factor for progression of smoldering multiple myeloma patients. Another thing, the interesting finding was that the MAPK pathway mutations, and like KRAS, NRAS, or BRAF mutations, when they were present in the smoldering stage, so patients at time of diagnosis who had any of these mutations, they were having 50% of them, they progressed within 22 months, compared to 4.5 years with patients who didn't harbor these mutations. So we think that this is considered like the first study on smoldering multiple myeloma and trying to track how the genetic mutation can contribute in the progression of the disease. And we have done this on 135 patients with smoldering multiple myeloma. With a total number of 186 bone marrows, because we had some patients who bone marrows which were at time of progression to multiple myeloma. So when we sequenced them, we were able to see how progression happens. If the mutations were present just in the smoldering stage, or they just occurred at the multiple myeloma stage, and what was like the clonal evolution of these mutations. So in summary for this one, we found that smoldering multiple myeloma is a heterogeneous group with patients having different clinical and genetic characteristics. So not only clinically we can stratify patients to high risk and low risk smoldering, but also like genetically we were able to do that. We found that MYC aberrations and MAPK pathway mutations were significant risk factors for progression and associated with shorter time to progression when they were present. One thing that, but unfortunately I didn't show this slide because it's somehow complex, we developed the model by incorporating the clinical variables, the three clinical variables by the Mayo risk model, with the two significant mutations or aberrations that we found here based on our study, and we found that by incorporating them and creating a model of four risk factors, giving one score for each variable, we found that patients who had the four risk factors were having a chance of progression of 60% in 2 years. We did this on 64 patients. We are now sequencing another 135 patients to validate this model, and then we can incorporate it or integrate and present it to the clinic so we can better stratify smoldering myeloma patients based on that. One other thing that we always talk about is early therapeutic intervention for smoldering myeloma patients. And here in Dana-Farber, actually, we were the first for trying to treat myeloma patients through clinical trials. And this is a Spanish trial that were done like previously in Europe. And they found that treating patients with RevDex versus observation, when they did it on 119 patients, they found that the progression-free survival in the treatment group was much longer in the treatment group compared to the observation, and this was published in 2013 in New England Journal of Medicine. They updated recently their findings, and they published it in Lancet Oncology, based on median follow-up time of 75 months, and it confirmed that the progression-free survival in the treatment arm was much longer than, and significantly longer than, the observation arm. And they reported even that the overall survival also was more significant in the treatment arm. Interestingly, they also, in the recent update, they mentioned that patients who relapsed after progression to symptomatic disease, so they treated them with Revlimid and dexamethasone, so they didn't find any resistance to Revlimid in patients who relapsed after treatment. We had some concerns about the methodology of this trial, but we are now doing it here at Dana-Farber through multiple trials to see if we really see more benefit in patients who are treated versus patients who are on observation. And these are the smoldering trials here at Dana-Farber. They're done by Dr. Paul Richardson and Dr. Irene Gobriel. So the vaccine trial that was mentioned before to train our immune system how to attack the myeloma cells. Another trial that is now complete for accrual is the elotuzumab Lindex for high-risk smoldering patients, and the daratumumab for intermediate and high risk, and this is now is opening as a phase 3 trial, and Dr. Paul Richardson mentioned it earlier that some of the findings in ASH were very interesting, and treating patients with smoldering multiple myeloma with daratumumab. Now enrolling is also like ixazomib Lindex for high risk smoldering, and this is currently enrolling nivolumab Lindex, and this was mentioned by Dr. Richardson and Dr. Anderson that nivolumab is one of the checkpoint inhibitors, but it's now on hold just to make sure of its like safety in patients. And there is a very recent opening for daratumumab in high-risk MGUS and low-risk smoldering patients. These are the results of the elotuzumab, the update of the results, and I think Irene presented it in the European Hematology Association annual meeting when they enrolled 50 patients. None of these patients progressed so far, and some of them achieved complete response, and others also very good partial response. Very briefly also, one of the things that we did in the Gorbia group is that we try to not only to understand these genomic and genetic abnormalities in the bone marrow by sequencing the bone marrow, but we always did that on what we call the blood biopsy or the cell-free DNA and circulating tumor cells. And the cell-free DNA and circulating tumor cells are just blood samples that we can get from the patients, which is easier. And then we, with certain technologies, we can detect the tumor DNA, which is released in the bloodstream from the cancer cells. And these tumor DNA, we can sequence it and try to see if we can find the same genetic abnormalities that we find in the bone marrow biopsies. And the good thing, we had like a recent paper that's going to be published in Nature, that we found a 90% concordance between the cell-free DNA and the bone marrow biopsy. Yet still, it's not very sensitive, but it's like a promising technique that we know that bone marrow biopsies sometimes are unpleasant and inconvenient for patients as diagnostic tools, but we're trying to optimize this technique now to see if there is, if we can have it as a surrogate for bone marrow biopsy in the future. This is like some results of this that we found that the cell-free DNA, the tumor fraction in the cell-free DNA increased with disease stages, with MGUS, smoldering myeloma, and newly diagnosed and relapsed multiple myeloma, and we found the same thing in the circulating tumor cells. Interestingly, also we found that the tumor fraction that was found in the cell-free DNA was concordant with the free light chains. So if we see an increase in the free light chains, we see also an increase in the tumor fraction. But we have also another advantage of sequencing the cell-free DNA that we can see what mutations or translocations are occurring in at time of relapse or at time of newly diagnosed patients. And this were also the same consistent findings that we found that the tumor fraction of the cell-free DNA was concordant with the clinical biomarkers, and sometimes it was found before finding an increase in these clinical biomarkers. Finally, I would like to thank my mentor, Irene Gabriel, and all the Gabriel lab team and clinical team who are taking care of the smoldering patient. I would like also to thank Dr. Paul Richardson, who has been taking care of many of the smoldering patients that we sequenced, and all the Dana-Farber myeloma program that we are really fortunate to be among them and learn from them. Also, I would like to thank our collaborators in the Broad Institute, in Mayo Clinic, and internationally in Greece and UK. And thank you all for your attention. Thanks.